In this lecture, we'll discuss about the perspective of conflict and authority as argued by Ralph Derendorf. We have already covered the conflict theory which is given by him. And in this lecture, we'll talk about what he has talked about authority and the importance of position in society. There's a quote, and we'll begin with that, that Derendorf has said himself, that the distribution of authority invariably becomes the determining factor of systematic social conflicts. That means the distribution and the position that is allotted with the authority, it becomes the factor which determines the social conflicts that will take place. It is important to notice that he has talked about the macro perspective of authority. That means he has talked about it in general with a larger scale. Therefore, his focus is on social facts. That means he has taken up the theory of social facts and integrated in macro perspective with conflict. So, when he talks about macro perspective, he talks about roles and position. We know that there are a lot of positions in the society, and with that position, they have a different kind of authority. For example, A grade services have different kind of authority, and B grade services have different kind of authority. Therefore, he says that authority resides in the position that one holds and not in the individual himself. For example, if I am an IAS officer, if I am at home, I do not hold that position at home, because at home I am not that IAS officer. At home, I am perhaps someone's wife, someone's mother, someone's daughter. I have different role to play. But when I am at work and the authority I have, it resides with my position as an IAS officer. Now let us understand the concept of authority that he has talked about. He said that the focus is on to study the structure of positions in the society, the conflicts among them. What are the conflicts that take place in the positions that are there in the society, and to analyze this conflict, to understand about it. The identification of authority roles. Now again, this is a macro or a large scale structure that he talks about. Now we'll further discuss what is this authority which is attached to position. He has talked about two aspects of authority. One is superordination and the second one is subordination. The one who has the authority, who has the power to control, is the superordinate, and they control the subordinates. So how do they actually control? What happens? So he said that there is an expectation of society, of the people who are around them, and they have this expectation with the position. Now again, let's go back to that example. If I am an IAS officer and if I'm sitting at my office, the people around me, everybody around me, they expect me as an IAS officer, as the position that I hold, to delegate authority, to delegate some work and to deliver that authority. I have to play that role because they have that expectation around of me. It may not be the case. Maybe I do not want to exert control or exert power, but the people around me, they have this kind of thought, they have this expectation which is regarded with that authority, and it has to be delivered. So it is not due to my psychological characteristic, it is not because of what I think as an individual, it is because of a large scale of people who have those expectations. Okay, so we can say that these expectations are attached to the position, and authority is specified in society. It is not generalized. That means the society tells you what kind of authority your position will play. What authority do you have as an IAS officer? What authority do you have as a chancellor, as a principal, as a teacher? This all is given by society. So it is not generalized. All these positions that I talked about, they do not have the same kind of authority. But Again, it is important to notice that authority is legitimate because it is given to you by the virtue of the position you hold. It is not the forced exertion of power, but it is legitimate. And since it is legitimate, those people who will not comply to it, who do not follow the instructions, they may be punished. So the next question that comes to mind is authority constant? Is it constant? No, it is not constant. Why? It is not constant because it resides in positions and not individuals. A very basic example can be, as an IAS officer, if I am serving the society, I have the authority in my position. If I retire, then I do not have that position. I do not have that authority. That means me as an individual, I do not have authority, but me as an IAS officer have authority. Another example, if X person holds authority in setting A, it not be the case in setting B. Now let us take an example of a husband and wife. Okay, just imagine the husband is perhaps a clerk and the wife is a lawyer or a judge. Now when they are working, the clerk is below the judge, below the wife, okay, in this case. So the husband is below the wife in the work setting. When they come back home, they are done with the position, they're done with the authority. When they are back home, their husband and wife. And the same husband who was perhaps serving the wife at office now asks the wife to go and make dinner. Now, the person who held the authority in office does not hold the same authority at home. That means authority is not constant. It also changes with the change in setting. So this is known as imperatively coordinated disassociation, as Derendorf called them. Arguing further, he says that authority is dichotomous. That means it can be divided. But only two conflict groups can exist within an association because one has the power and the other does not. He has talked about the term interests. That means contradictory interests in substance and direction are held by both parties. Okay, the one who has power, that person will want it to stay the same. And the one who does not have power, he will want his position to change. He will want to get more power. So it is said that the group at the top and the group at the bottom, they sometimes have common interests. For him, interests are also large scale. They are not psychological phenomena. They are also governed by the society. As subordinates keep seeking change, the legitimacy of authority is precarious. That means it can be shaken, it can fall apart, but it is on the basis of conflict of interest. If there is a conflict of interest, the authority will be shaken. Interests are therefore objective in nature. How are they objective? They are objective because they are reflected in roles that are attached to the position. Okay, so what my position is, I have an authority related to it, and the interests also are going to be related to that. Now, explaining more about interests, he has talked about latent and manifest interests. So what are these latent interests? These are the unconscious role expectations, okay? You do not need to internalize them. It is not like socialization. It is not like you have to imbibe them. No, they are unconscious role expectations. That means when a teacher comes to the class, you expect the teacher to teach you. Okay, so she does not have to remind herself that, okay, I'm coming to the class because I have to teach. No, this is an unconscious role expectation. On the other hand, manifest interests are one when the latent interests, the unconscious role expectations, they become conscious. That is when they turn into manifest interests. So the individuals, they adjust or they adapt to the roles and they start behaving in an expected manner. For example, a new teacher whose role is to teach will Unconsciously, she knows that I have to teach, but as time passes, she adjusts to that role. She prepares better notes. She is more prepared to deliver the lecture, to handle the class, and that is when it becomes a manifest interest. Now, he said that the task of conflict theory is to analyze the connection between these two interests. Okay, when you analyze, only then you can understand that there is a conflict of interest, and it is when conflict will arise. Okay, now let us discuss some questions. Who said that those who study behavioral or psychological characteristics of individuals or individual level are not sociologists? This was said by Derrindorf because he believed that sociology is the study of macro perspective or large scale perspective. Now there are two statements. Statement one, association of people is controlled by hierarchy of authority and position. He said that authority and position determine the association of people. Statement 2, an individual can be superordinate in one and subordinate in another setting due to various associations in the society. This we discuss with the example of husband and wife, where one is a judge and the other is a clerk. So the answer will be option 3, both the statements are true. I hope you got the lecture. Thank you for watching.